Good evening to one and all present here. I, Arundhati Mukherjee from Revert Media, we are delighted to have your presence at this webinar today. We welcome you all to today's webinar on the topic Issues related to deterioration and service life of concrete elements in Indian context. This webinar is organized by Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center, in association with Civil Engineering and Construction Review, powered by Revert Media Private Limited. We would like to begin this webinar by welcoming Engineer Mayank Rawal, who is the Director of Asian Laboratories and Co-Chairman, Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center.
Thank you. I'm Mayank Rawal, Co-Chairman, ICI, New Delhi Center. Welcome you all. It's my great pleasure to invite you all today for the 11th webinar in the series of webinar our center is holding. Today's presentation topic is issues related to deterioration and service life of concrete elements in Indian context. I welcome speaker for today's presentation, a very renowned name in concrete technology, Dr. Biswajit Bhattacharyaji, Emeritus Professor, Civil Engineering Department, IIT Delhi. I also welcome today's panelists. We have today Dr. VVL Kantarao, Senior Principal Scientist, CSIR, CRRI, Honorary Secretary, Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center. I also would like to welcome today's moderator, Engineer Rajiv Singhalji, Chief Engineer, CPWD, Chairman, Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center. I welcome ICI New Delhi Center team also, and welcome ICI President Headquarter, Engineer Vinay Guptaji, ICI Vice President North, Engineer Supradeep Dasji, Chairman New Delhi Center, Engineer Rajiv Singhalji. I welcome our Honorary Secretary, Dr. VVL Kantaraoji. I welcome our Treasurer, Dr. B.V. Badwaji. I also welcome our media partner, Messrs. Rever Media team and CECR team, especially Mr. Praveer Bhattacharyaji. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Now we would like to welcome Engineer Rajiv Singhal, who is a Chief Engineer in CPWD, Chairman, Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Arunditi. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Well, as Mr. Rawal has said, this is our 11th webinar, which we are holding since 31st of July in this series. And this is the 11th one in association with CNCR and Revert Media. And otherwise, it is our 13th from 31st of July. This is our 13th webinar. And with cooperation of all the audience and all the team members of ICI, we have been holding webinars without any break. And I hope and pray that we continue this trend and keep on holding a webinar on a contemporary topic on every Saturday. Now I will give you a brief about the New Delhi Center. New Delhi Center is one of the 44 centers of Indian Concrete Institute, which is a non-profit body aiming to promote scientific research in the field of concrete technology and concrete applications. It was founded in Chennai way back in 1982, around 39 years back on 7th of September. And to commemorate the founding of Indian Concrete Institute, the centers of ICI spread all over the country. They celebrate Concrete Day in the month of September. If not on 7th, they hold it on any other convenient day in the month of September to commemorate the founding of Indian Concrete Institute. Well, Indian Concrete Institute has grown from a small body around 4 decades back to a body having 13,000 members spread all over the country. Today, it has got around 44 centers and 275 student chapters in the country, and we are one of them. We have a membership of around 300, and I take this opportunity to request all of you to become members of Indian Concrete Institute. You can go to our website, www.indianconcreteinstitute.org, and you go to the icon or link for the membership, and you will get all the details required for becoming members of ICI. is not very heartening to note that out of lakhs of civil engineers, only 13,000 are members of ICI. So I exhort you to kindly take membership. You will not regret becoming members of ICI. Well, ICI had also planned to hold ACCON 2020 in the month of September 20, which we could not hold due to the pandemic. So, which we plan to hold in the coming year, in the first quarter. I will let you know of the details as soon as the situation further improves, as it is improving now. So, I also take this opportunity to welcome all of you to this webinar on issues related to deterioration and service life of concrete elements from Dr. Vishwajit Bhattacharjee. I am very grateful to him that he has been a blessing for us. He attends our webinars and enlightens us with his great knowledge in the field of concrete construction, either as a panelist or as a speaker. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I also welcome Dr. Kanta Rao, who is our panelist for today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Introducing to you all, Engineer Supradeep Das, who is the current Vice President, North Indian Concrete Institute and Vice Chairman of BISCED 41 Committee.
Hello, thanks, Isha. Good afternoon, Rajiv Ji, Dr. Kanta Rao, Mayank, and members of New Delhi Center, participants and attendees. It's a great pleasure to be here and welcome you all in this webinar on issues related to deterioration and service life concrete elements in Indian context, being delivered by our esteemed guest, Dr. Vishwajit Bhattacharya. I am thankful to him. Whenever we need somebody to give a technical deliberation, he is always there with us. Thanks a lot, Dr. Bhattacharya. I welcome him. I am confident that his presentation would be of immense value to the participants. By the way, this webinar is being organized by New Delhi Center in association with CES and CR and 11th in series. I congratulate NDC Center. It's a great achievement. As VP of ICI, I would urge the participants to become the member of the esteemed professional body and enjoy a host of benefits. My presentation on ICI would be focused on the activities of India's esteemed professional body on cement, concrete, and construction. Can you see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, Indian Concrete Institute, in the service of promoting concrete technology and construction, we have just introduced our new website, www.indianconcreteinstitute.org. In that website, you can visit the website, can have lots of information regards to cement, concrete, and construction. As Mr. Rajiv Singhalji told you that ICI was founded in 1982 with its headquarters at Chennai. We have got around 13,000 members, 44 centers spread across India. We have 351 organizational members, 267 student chapters. Our objective is to promote growth of concrete construction and its specializations, to disseminate knowledge and information for needs of changing concept, to train personnel, collaborate with national and international agencies in creating better understanding of concrete construction technology, to identify R&D issues, encourage outstanding achievements in concrete construction technology through its institutional awards, to collaborate with national and international agencies like ACI, ACF, Singapore Concrete Institute, Concrete Institute of Australia, to institute and distribute awards for achievement of concrete construction technology, to arrange lecture series on selected topics of relevance to concrete construction. ICI also organizes periodical seminars, conference, workshops, and exhibition on the subject and arranges lecture series. ICI publishes quarterly journal containing peer-reviewed technical papers, technical abstracts from 40 journals, and also has also brought out number of publication monographs on various related topics. Advisory services. ICI offers an industry advisory services for problem solving in design, construction, maintenance, and repairs. We have the fold of the captains of the construction industry. The whole sphere of the construction you can find in our membership, building material manufacturers, leading consultant, designer, contractors, academicians, educational institutions, lab equipment manufacturers, material testing laboratory, students. And this knowledge is disseminated through workshops, seminars, webinars, conferences, exhibitions, webinars, whatever way it's possible, we are disseminating the knowledge. We have around 11 technical committees of consisting of renowned technocrats in cement, concrete, and construction. And through these committees, they are based on the fiber reinforced concrete admixtures, guidelines specifying durability, industrial flooring, mechanized sand, repair and rehabilitation of structure, waterproof guidelines for waterproofing system. And through these technical committee, we have come out with 11 technical publications. There are fiber reinforced concrete, precast construction of buildings, concrete admixtures, unified code for concrete construction, CD West, decorative concrete, concrete durability, concrete flooring. And just last week, the waterproofing of concrete structure was published and released by our esteemed president, Mr. Engineer Vinay Gupta. And these publications are also available in hard copies. If any participants wants this handbooks, they can just write to the headquarters or to the journal vice president or to the journal chair or to the center chairman, they can have it. Otherwise, these publications are available in our website. We have a joint initiative with the government bodies like CPWD, BIS, BMTPC, IRC, CBRI, municipal bodies, state PWDs. As I told you that during my profile that I am also a member of waterproofing committee of BIS. So that helps in interaction between the professional bodies and the government agencies. Annual awards. In line with the center's annual awards, ICI headquarters also instituted 5-6 annual awards. They are Lifetime Achievement, Outstanding Concrete Technologist, Dr. A. Ramakrishna Award, Best Paper on Innovative Construction Methodology, Outstanding Pre-stressed Concrete Structure, Young Scientist Award. They are, every year they are distributed or awarded during the holding of holding of AGM. We also have two branded events, that ASICON and IWC. ASICON is Asian Conference on Ecstasy in Concrete, celebrated once in 4 years. IWC, Innovative World of Concrete, celebrated once in 5 years. It's a unique platform in which experts from all over the world participate and share their experience. This time, ICI NDC was supposed to organize this ICI ASICON 2020, but due to pandemic, now this has been postponed, and hopefully this will be celebrated or organized in the second quarter of 2022. Concrete Day on 7th of September every year. This is an annual event to celebrate the formation of ICI. Then we have a student chapter, and any educational institution having more than 50 students in civil and allied engineering can request the chairman of the nearby center or the vice president to become a student chapter of the ICI. These are the guidelines. So our growth is undeterred, goals are high, targets are far-reaching. We remain committed to the society and large, and concrete lovers in particular. So, you know, you are, as you all know, that ICI NDC has collaborated with CNCR and River Media for all online and physical events in future. Today's webinar is 11th in the series, and propose to have events much in online and physical jointly in the coming days. I would now present C and CR and River Media to all. Thank you.
Civil Engineering and Construction Review, a leading infrastructure monthly on methods, materials, and machinery. Celebrating 34 years of publication. CE and CR is India's number one infrastructure monthly news journal for the past 34 years. We have been.
No sound.
Sound was there. आपके शायद माइक्रोफोन बंद हो गया.
Rinisa.
Sound is there, sir.
Rinisa, no sound.
Sound is there.
Sir, आपका माइक्रोफोन बंद हुआ होगा सर.
Providing discerning knowledge and an unmatched coverage of the construction sector since 1988. Get social with the largest online construction media network of India. Civil Engineering and Construction Review provides a valuable, informative, unmatched high-quality content. It is the most circulated magazine in India, having a readership over 17 countries worldwide. Google rank number one under the search of Civil Engineering Magazine India and Construction Magazine India. We have a 5-star rating as well. Currently stands at 58,000 plus followers on Facebook. 16,500 plus industry professionals connected on LinkedIn. You can also find us on other social media platforms such as Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and SoundCloud. No one around us in India.
Introducing Revered Media, a 360 degrees logistics solutions of business events. Who we are and what we do. Revered Media is an independent, full-service, professional logistics solutions company for business events. We specialize in corporate events with end-to-end event project management. Our commitment is to see each event through from the start to finish, while keeping the goals, vision, budget, and our clients' needs in mind at all times. We manage your events from conceptualization to execution, saving you the long hours, late nights, and endless emails, so that you can focus on what's essential to you. We represent leading international exhibition organizers for promotion of their shows in India as well. Our unique selling proposition are: we have a focused and contemporary approach. Wide contacts, rich experience in conceiving and managing high-profile events. Working within deadlines and budget with maximum mileage and strong marketing instincts. We specialize in various types of events such as webinars, seminars, conferences, exhibitions, social media marketing, EDMs and e-newsletters, workshops, promotional advertisement and designing, public relations, product launch, award ceremonies, roadshows and many more. Our vision includes growth, innovation, affordability and quality services. Contact us and join hands with Revered Media.
I would like to request our moderator for the day, Engineer Rajiv Sindhu, to introduce our esteemed speaker and panelist of today's webinar. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Well, our speaker for the day is Dr. Biswajit Bhattacharji. Yeah, Dr. Bhattacharji is an emeritus professor at the Department of Civil Engineering in IIT Delhi. He obtained his BTech honors degree from IIT Kharagpur, and then M.Tech and Ph.D. degrees from IIT Delhi. And he worked for Gammons India for 2 years after his B.Tech. He is a fellow of Indian Association of Structural Engineers and a member of several professional bodies like Indian Concrete Institute. He has been involved with academic activities with several international institutions like EPFL of Switzerland, University of Dundee, UK, University of Dresden, Germany, Catholic University at Leuven in Belgium. He is also involved with the industry as a consultant. Dr. Bhattacharji has supervised more than 170 M.Tech and 26 Ph.D. theses till date, and is currently guiding 7 ongoing Ph.D. research projects. He has published more than 180 papers in journals and conferences. He is active in several international committees like DST, CBRI, NCCBM, Dr. Fixit Laboratory, and BIS, etc. He is also a recipient of ICI Lifetime Achievement Award North in 2012. He has acted as a member of the editorial board of Magazine of Concrete Research and International Journal of TRs. He is also a guest editor of Indian Concrete Journal also. Yeah, our panelist for the day is Dr. VVL Kantarao. Dr. Kantarao is also honorary secretary of ICANDC, and he is a senior principal scientist in CSIR CRRI. He has done his PhD from IIT Delhi, and then he joined CSIR CRRI as a scientist in 1993, and is currently working as a senior principal scientist in Bridge Engineering and Structures Division of CRRI. He has pursued his research in areas like polymer concrete, high performance concrete, corrosion protective coatings on reinforcement bars, protective coatings on concrete surfaces, CND waste in concrete, self-compacting concrete, fiber-added cement concrete, etc. He is a designated professor in the Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research of CSIR and has supervised several PhD studies and M.Tech and B.Tech dissertations. I welcome Dr. Kantarao and our speaker for the day, Dr. Biswajit Bhattacharya, and I invite him to deliver his lecture. Dr. Biswajit Bhattacharya, please.
Sir, you are on mute.
Sir, you are on mute. Yeah.
No, it's okay.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, Mr. Rajiv Singhalji, Mr. Mayank Rawal, Dr. Rao, Kantarao, my friend, and Mr. Supradeep Das. Thank you very much, ICI Delhi chapter, for giving me this opportunity. I must also thank Revered Media and CECR, Ms. Bhattacharya and Ms. Mukherjee and Prabir Bhattacharya. Thank you very much. Normally, you know, and good afternoon to everybody, everyone in the audience. Normally, I do not ask or request for a talk, but this time I have done. There's a reason. There are two reasons. One is that you can see that these are some of my, some thoughts, rather point of views, you can say, what I'm going to present, certain issues, I think the way we should, you know, look into some of the things in the Indian context. And second point is, one of my students who worked in a similar area, you know, he was working for his master's project, passed away and couldn't complete his work. So part of his work I'll be presenting, at least referring to his work. So that's the reason. Thank you very much. If I can share my screen, then I'll go to my screen.
Yeah.
Is the screen visible?
Not yet,
sir.
Yes, is it?
No, sir.
Okay, just let me see. Sharing the screen, where from? You share the screen. Chat, share screen, yes. So now it must be sharing. Does it share now?
Yeah, it's open, yes.
Right. So this is the topic. And issues related to deterioration and service life of concrete element in Indian context. And obviously I'd like to dedicate this to late Chandrasekhar Prasad, Joint Director MES, Chief Engineer Delhi Zone. He was doing his M.Tech Structural Engineering 2019 to 21 and passed away while working before finishing his master's project. He was an excellent, dedicated fellow, you know, and he's quite senior, but very hardworking. Some of his experimental results, few, I'll be presenting in this, and I thought I should dedicate this particular talk to him. I suppose in your screen, Revered Media would, CECR also is projecting his photograph. So, you know, this is dedicated to him. He's extremely hardworking, yeah, and you know, he was, I mean, during the experimental phase, one day he called me and I came to know that he called me because he was going to the hospital. He was getting recovered. I was getting news from friends. And then finally, I don't know what happened. One fine day, one of his colleagues, who was also a student, my student as well, informed me that he's no more. So we actually lost a very good officer, engineer, and a great student. And I dedicate this talk to him. Right, so coming to the talk, this is, of course, a little bit of quick definitions. Durability of structure, component, etc., is capability to maintain minimum performance level over a specified time when exposed to some degradation environment. Material degrades. Elements deteriorate. And in structures, you might see distress and damages. Damages are different, right? And that's what it is. So performance and measurement of fulfillment of functions, structures should be able to take load. And performance varies with time, and degradation is gradual decrease of performance with time. So material, as I said, you know, so from basic thermodynamic consideration, this I might have presented a number of times, but still I present this because I think this is a fundamental of durability, that you give some energy and raise the level of the material or element to a higher level. And this will, like raising a body up. So you have given some potential energy. Here, of course, you give some potential energy in terms of energy like thermal or whatever it is. So gives free energy, that's what you are. So no, we're not talking of those. But you can control the rate. So it will have a tendency to come up. If it is kept on a platform, it will remain there, but it will have a tendency to come up. And if you take time, log time, et cetera, the kinetics, the rate. So rate can be different. So you can control the rate, but man-made material will be somewhere here. Therefore, it would deteriorate. Tendency cannot be controlled because you have made it, you have given energy, steel, concrete, whatever you call it. Performance can vary because it will have a tendency to come, but some rate it will come. If it is this is fine, but otherwise it will vary because it will, you know, there will be some sort of deterioration. And this is how it may reduce. So therefore, concrete cannot be maintenance free because you produce at the expense of energy and degrades with time, but you'd like to have as much as time as possible. And when you want to quantify durability, then we do it in units of time. That is service life. So this definition I just wanted to give. And this is degradation specific. It will vary whether it is chloride ingress or reinforcement corrosion followed by chloride ingress, et cetera, and so many other things. It very degradation specific. Degradation is caused by sulfate attack, seawater, alkali aggregate reaction, et cetera, in concrete. Again, a little bit of school level, engineering level, BTEC or a master's level thoughts. So these are all chemical changes, sometimes physical too, but all chemical changes may not lead to deterioration. Only when performance is lowered, then I call it deterioration in engineering sense. And service life is related to deterioration. So it can actually, this is the kind of model people use, right, with time. Basically, deterioration can increase and it can reach a level where it is acceptable. You maintain it, and several cycle up to what is called intended design life. But you can repair it in such a manner that it can go to the last level itself, do a good repair, or even it may straight away go there. I mean, you might design the system to straight away go maintenance-free service life up to intended design life. Anyway, so durability is quantified in terms of TSL equals to TIDL. TSL is the service life. When you do the repair, et cetera, you know, you have to definitely reach a serviceability limit. But if it is equals to intended design life, perfect durability. Okay, so one can look into what you call life cycle cost, repair frequency, etc. I am not going to look into this. Not today. Degradation processes that is common to concrete, as we know, because not every material degrades in the same manner. You have given energy to all, but depends. In a conducive situation, they react. Materials from environment can react and cause performance degradation. So in the context of concrete, these are sulfate attack, seawater attack, and etc. Acid attack and carbonation and chloride ingress. They are not problem per se, but they can lead to river corrosion. And all in water solution. Alkali aggregate reaction, there also you need water. Frost action, you need water. Now, the last one, this is one of the major problems we see in Indian scenario or worldwide even, but reasons are different. And quite often it leads to early repair. Now, since all of them, deterioration process involves moisture ingress, therefore, relative humidity has got a good role. It's very important. Relative humidity plays a big role, right? Moisture, relative humidity is the moisture vapor present in air divided by saturation moisture vapor. Maximum it can hold on in a gas phase solution, basically. And it has been seen that around 55 to 60, the peak of carbonation occurs. And corrosion possibly 70 to 80, or somewhere next slide, I might say about 60 to 90, slightly wider. So service life requires modeling of moisture ingress. That's very important. That's perhaps more important in tropical countries than elsewhere. But I'm not talking of too much of model today, only contextual I'll be. So this is what we are saying. And causes we have seen 60 to 90% RH in the wider sense. And this is from past literature. I mean, you know, one can see those. And carbonation and chloride, they induce corrosion, and carbonation takes place 50 to 70% RH. Now, if you have no moisture, nothing will happen. So that is to be understood. Chloride transport, if it is occurring, that too occurs in presence of water. Therefore, water plays an active role in the evolution of degradation processes in concrete. But anyway, I'm not going to discuss this too much right now. I'll discuss this later on. So therefore, this is a very important issue, but I'm not going to talk right now. For exposed concrete sources, of course, atmospheric humidity and rain penetration. Marine condition may bring in chloride. Relatively drier location would have less sensitivity. The zones of service life prediction shall be defined based on climatic precipitation condition and marine exposure. You know, and service life prediction, I'm saying prescriptive, right now we have 5 borrowed from BSA 8110, or there could be some changes. But if you are looking really some changes, tropical India should look in a different manner than Europe or North America. So guidelines of subtropical latitude, North America and Europe may not be directly applicable to tropical Indian condition. It is somewhat, you know, north-south divide, as in economists or socioeconomists would call. The north is developed, south is not so developed. And it so happens all the norths are subtropical, and their research, when we are borrowing, we have a little bit of problem because blindly borrowing. I mean, if we borrow it, fine, but with understanding. Therefore, we must look to this. And this is a point of view I'd like to point out, and people should look into it. For example, de-icing salt is not used in India. So chloride ingress due to de-icing salt is absent. But still, we have chloride tests done in Delhi. RCPT. I was shocked when first times a major infrastructure construction person said, why aren't you using RCPT for the durability, you know, some durability appraisal of some things where there are some distress. I said, RCPT, Delhi is 1400 kilometers away from Chisholm at least. Why should we do RCPT at all? And it's a migration test. Anyway, I'll come to that later on. Construction practice is quite different, less mechanized. because the cost of hiring a crane is much less in those countries, vis-a-vis cost of hiring labor. If you compare, there are basically kind of understanding available that where cost of hiring equipment is less relative to cost of hiring a labor for concrete construction, it's more mechanized. We believe still semi-mechanized or non-engineered. So here structure, it is quite different. Structural element is quite different. Phenomena of deterioration quite different. And case investigations, if all of us compile, that can give in what is our problem. Well, cases I have encountered over the last 30 years, I'm trying to give some idea to something related to this, and then go back again to moisture and things like that. These cases do not include intrinsic cracks like thermal cracks or shrinkage cracks that I have come across, but mostly to deterioration of concrete. So we did, as consultant, this when nobody having instrument in this city, IITs and NCCBM, CRRI would have, and people would come to us for doing test, investigation, and all those that I did from 1990 to 2005, some of them I have tried to compile, and later on ones also. So most of the cases, objectives were diagnosis of corrosion distress and extent of distress for repair. But those days in the beginning cases, we are not very sure. Sometimes, if now somebody comes to me and I see I diagnose it as a corrosion problem, then I am not going to do core test there. Strength test, I am not going to do that. Although many consultants suggest that way. But those days we are doing. Some of the cases where nothing happened, they also involved us for routine testing. I mean, I can name that particular organization, very progressive, Reserve Bank of India. Nothing happened to its structures. There's a main building, the one which is guarded by Yaksh and Yakshi in Parliament Street. And it is a sculpture by Ram Kinkar Bej. These two Yaksha and Yakshi guarding its excellent structure. Nothing happened to it, but they wanted us to look at it. So that also included in my data. Some of them no distress, a lot of them no distress. So 13 cases of my IIT Delhi and 9 from MTech people who did, they also collected. They reported whenever they came to us, the age I took it. And next table summarizes all this. So there are 22, I could, later also I have done after 2005, but unfortunately I have not compiled them so far. But these are the ones which I compiled because I wanted to, and actually this work is published in AC India Journal, chapter, first issue. That's there available, but anyway, I presented it elsewhere also sometime, but some more additional I'll do. So there are types of buildings buried from residential, textile factory, office basement, residential, chemical factories, miscellaneous factories, hostels, etc., and university building and so on. And then the construction types were load-bearing masonry, RCC, RCC frame, RCC frame, these are there. And you can see a number of stories varied from single story to, I think there are somewhere 20 stories were also there. This is maximum is basement plus 13 story, 21 story, yes. There is one basement of an office, 21 stories. And age at which they came to us, 25 to 50, 50, 50, and one is 5. So you see 5 to 50, it varied. When either 50, one of them at least, when they came to us, it had no defect, but they wanted to have a test done, thorough, complete. And 1950 was the construction year. And others, 5, obviously serious distress. So all distresses were there. Then Then, you know, this next slide missed out. Then, of course, since, you know, as I said, it was a lack of my understanding sometime, that we also did ultrasonic and core stress, although distress was some cases corrosion, but many other cases they wanted us to do. So USPB, core strength, ratio of cover to carbonation depth, not all places, because there must have been corrosion distress, there we have done. pH of concrete and free chloride concentration we measured. Water soluble chloride. Because at that, you know, water soluble chloride is responsible for corrosion process at a given time, right? Corrosion processes at a given time. So water soluble chloride we have been doing because that would tell you whether it have a potential of corrosion which is occurring. So this also we did. And took this data. I mean, this is available in literature. It tells you about carbonation to cover depth 1, moderate risk, et cetera, and chloride. This is by weight of cement, right? This is by weight of cement, and this is high. So this is a threshold value above which corrosion would be high. This is for diagnosis purpose, not for new concrete. So we'll come to this also. And this is equivalent, also you can find out. Mangi and Millard gives you a way to calculate this equivalent. And then we plotted one diagram I'm showing. I plotted with several of other factors. Ultrasound pulse velocity, because soundness of concrete plays a role. And approximate time when they came to us, age at repair, it showed a linear trend. So objective was this analysis was to identify major causes resulting to rebar corrosion in many cases. And we found 72% of those buildings had chloride above threshold level. This is based on literature, Bisara's paper. I think I've taken it on a slight air set. Some paper will say 0.015% by mass of cement. Mass of concrete, not of cement. Because you'll do chloride test on concrete, make concrete powder, dissolve it in distilled water in a standard manner. And silver nitrate, mercury nitrate, titration, et cetera, you can do. Today, these days it has become very easy. First time when my student did, he was doing with burette and pipette, but then now we have all Carl Fischer type of titration, automatic electrochemical titration are there, and relatively pretty easy. 31% building showed carbonation. And we fitted a curve with velocity, ultrasound velocity, strength, and the cover depth. And of course, R square value was 0.84 square. So quite a good fit, I'll say. And you can see that sound concrete showed much less. This was higher when the concrete was sound. Cover depth was a casualty. It had also some effect. Anyway, we could have done better statistical analysis. At that point, I didn't do anything. Concrete, all of them are OPC cement because they're the old ones. And all were mild steel bars. Some were mild steel, some were CTD, cold to state deform bars, that is your tor bars. So this is, in between the data is there, but I think I didn't compile. But then because it was getting routine stuff, right? But recently I had the chance to look into two buildings and their data is quickly available. And they're important in the sense that they came to us 7-8 years. And the very look of it, it tells me that it is internal chloride. The chloride must have been there right from the first day. So that this depassivation would have occurred. Otherwise, it cannot happen in 7 to 8 years. There are a lot of water seepage from the ground into the basement. And I also studied the water in the surrounding. It was brackish water, but didn't have not a little bit of HCO3. H2CO3 was there in the water, but it's not a very significant one, you know, like there's some amount. And I thought that if that was the reason for carbonation, I mean, carbon dioxide penetrating into the, you know, carbon pH reduction of the concrete, but that was not the thing. So we measured this. and we measure the free chloride, relative moisture content and resistivity. I asked them to measure resistivity of concrete, in situ concrete directly. It was already 7 to 2 years old. They have repaired part of it. And interestingly, since the water was seeping at the ground, I thought, is it the ground basement where the problem is there maximum? Chloride is there maximum? I mean, water is coming from the basement. Well, it was not so, because we then looked into the ascending order of heights, right? Ascending order of heights of the building, the 9-story building. So meters height, various heights we have taken chloride. And you see it even 6 meter, the chloride is high. 33 meter chloride is high. So this is all random. So the chloride didn't come from the groundwater that was seeping through. And we then plotted histogram. This is for a particular block. Good lot of them are pretty low, class interval 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the ranges of the chloride, I'll just tell you. And this is a 6th class interval, which was, so if you look at it 0 to 5, this was above threshold. Highest value was 0.069, and least value was, there must be somewhere, minimum is 0.008. And then we divided according to the statistical formulae with the data, you know, there's a way to do the number of class interval you need, 6-class interval. And you can see that this is, and plenty of them are 6 data were here. But in this particular block, of course, the number of data point here was maximum, as you can see in the previous diagram, 14 points were there, 6. Class, there also, there are 8 to 9. So there are a lot of, so from here onwards, all are above threshold values, but good lot of them here and good lot of them, of course, below the threshold chloride. Good lot of them below the threshold chloride. So all buildings, if I just took one particular tower, there are many towers there, and we took all towers, again, we plotted histogram. And majority did not have, but there are a number of them where the chloride, it was above the chloride threshold. This is the class, you know, this summary of the histogram plot. The least value was 0.0008, very little. Highest value was 0.0958, but there was only one there. Majority was between this. And if I look from threshold value, somewhere here above threshold values. So you see, chloride is diagnosis then. Known critical concentration of chloride, depth of carbonation penetration, and carbon depth of carbonation penetration. Uniform chloride means internal chloride. So, you know, it is actually internal chloride because it's going to the top, bottom, everywhere you find chloride. It was not coming from outside water seeping through. And profile of high chloride at the surface means external chloride. We have, you know, so some cases external chloride actually we finally ruled out. Because if external chloride was there, I would have seen it maximum at the basement only, not at higher level so much. We did further analysis to this. So same diagram I used to find out chloride, but then chloride threshold was known. Now they did already did some repair, you know. So there are 9 towers in the common basement and total work done in square meter of repair. They did patch repair of corrosion. And again, it came. That's why I was brought in. They had other consultants before. So I was called in when, why it is coming again and again. So we find that repair till date, you know, major repair they have done. This building had more repair done. This had less, least, basement had plenty of it. Then what I thought was, I thought I should plot it. First of all, in each tower, find out the probability of depassivation. That is number of chloride tested, sample having chloride higher than this. So 1 divided by 31, that's the probability of finding chloride. Probability of finding chloride and this J, which was I showing, it had around 50% chloride more than threshold value. That is 0.025 criteria, 71% and so on and so forth. And then this was the repair cost, repaired area, not cost, repaired area. So I thought let's plot probability of depassivation, because as per the chloride threshold, and the repair area, and it was fitting a linear line. Where probabilities were low, repair areas were also low. And it confirmed me that it would have come to this particular set of towers from ingredients. Otherwise, only basement would have maximum, others would have much less, but it was other towers as well. So case B, again 7 to 8 years, you know, but here we didn't do the test. I've given up testing some years back because there are now private parties who can test. So they, when they, somebody comes and asks me, can we, I said, it's very difficult. And my technical hands who are very trained and very good, they all retired much before me. So I decided not to do testing anymore, right? Dr. Rao would be knowing one of them whose name I'll mention, Badlaramji, who's a great man. Anyway, so those people retired. And there was another one, Mr. Bhajan Singh, who also retired. So then I said, I'll not do any more testing. Testing will be done by private parties. And if they ask me, I give 3-4 names or 5-6 names. You go and bid, you know, take quotation from them and go and do the testing. If any one of them asks me for some advice, otherwise, learning, that I have been doing. But otherwise, as no, you know, I stopped doing testing. So somebody did the testing and we suggested what test should be done. And we said the three chloride test you do. You don't have to do too many things, free and total chloride and carbonation, because it's corrosion simple. And out of 13, they found 4 carbonated, 12 samples of free chloride, 13 samples of total chloride. And mean free chloride was something like this again, above threshold. And total chloride was 1.35, standard deviation is something like this, et cetera, et cetera. Carbonation was less. So this was, again, we find it is chloride. Out of those 22, 16 had inbuilt internal chloride. And 7 to 8 years when people are coming, that definitely is internal chloride. So the number of distresses because of any other kind of chemical attack, deterioration, very rare. I'll mention only 2 of them, which I have come across. Carbonation alone, I have not found so far. And that's why I thought that let me have a look at somewhere in the seashore. Now, all this data that is there, there's various parts of India, although majority is from North India, but they belong to East, belong to South as well. This was my student who was doing something, and he had to actually survey some 9 buildings, do some testing. And I said, you don't have to do anything. You do only chloride test, free and total chloride test, right? I mean, water soluble and concentrated nitric acid, 6 normal nitric acid concentrated solution test you do. And incidentally, there are age variation in the structures when they did repair. So I could even, possibly I thought I could even estimate the service life with respect to this. And since this was very close to the seashore, I thought that it would possibly give me some idea related to whether it is the windward side from the sea or seaward side is more corrosion affected and you know, sea wind direction, because aerosol blown from the sea might have actually caused chloride concentration, but I also surprised. But unfortunately, he couldn't complete his thesis, and this is part of his results. I was expecting that there'll be a chloride profile. I might see something like this, you know, at the surface, high chloride, inside less. This phase maximum, this phase less, this phase least, because this sea wind is from this direction. But to my surprise, it was not so. It was, again, uniform chloride all over the place. This is the threshold. This is its total chloride. And this is 5 centimeter depth from the surface, from some elements. And this is inside. In fact, surface was less. It might have washed away, I thought. But looks, again, the internal chloride seems to be bothering, even in the seashore. That means people are not really careful. This red line is threshold chloride. Everywhere the threshold, more than threshold chloride. There are 9 such buildings which we are supposed to test. And he was getting data from there and testing. But very few, 1 or 2 cases, I think I might have been able to see. So this is another building. And again, the seashore, and not because it will take otherwise. This is the case where I saw this, you know, chloride is higher on the face and less inside. So this might be, I mean, if everyone was getting every sample she was testing, every location he was testing, if I would have got something like this, I would have said that it is external chloride. And it was, again, random, not for a given phase, wind direction, distance from the sea, nothing. Nothing. So it was again internal chloride. Now this is a bit too much. I was not expecting this in any manner, right? So this is the third building he could test. And 90 meter orientation of building from the north, etc., etc. And distances from the sea also was different for all three of them. And again, here we got somewhere external, you know, what do you call, total chloride, acid soluble chloride more, less inside, but otherwise very rarely one or two cases we saw. Most of the cases it was random and the variation was quite significantly not different for all this. This is again outside more, inside less, but free chloride was less here, so binding, chloride binding and all that. So, you know, this is the kind of results we got. And the deviation here, although is there, but some cases, it's not very significant, 0.10 to 0.08. So some cases we saw, we thought it can say, tell us it could have been external, but then when you look at the total, then free, again, you are confused. And then finally, we came to the conclusion that these are all internal chloride. These are all internal chloride and nothing to do with the external chloride. Only two cases I came across which were different. One is that this particular one, alkali aggregate reaction, somewhere in Northeast. Dams they had, Rihand dams, Hirakud dams they had, structures very rarely. But where aggregates have not been used, there you can have this kind of thing. And this is, you know, they ignored it, they even didn't know, they in fact went for a structural analysis, did everything possible, some epoxy filling. Actually, when I look at it, I thought map cracking, which I could see there, something of this kind for some other structures where they use the same aggregate, told me that perhaps it is alkali aggregate reaction. So I took broken pieces which were available and alkali silica you can see. So one time, only in over the last 30, 35 years, I came across one alkali aggregate reaction. So it's not a major problem in India. One has to take care. And they had a problem. They had a problem because they could not have done anything. They almost finished their, you know, aggregates. And then they just got some aggregates from nearby state where also construction has been very little. And that aggregate, they did not even know that this was creating alkali aggregate reaction. Anyway, there were not much solution available to us. Because how to stop moisture in the whole thing? You can't change aggregate. There are ways possibly, but I didn't follow it up further. This is one case of internal sulfate. The cracks were something like this, you know, in a column, flat slab. And it appeared to me at the center of the column, there were external pressure. So that's what, from the structural visualization, it was coming, if the crack is occurring, the corner is going out at the center and the rebars are all, it's around 8 months old concrete, 10 months old concrete, no load, nothing. So some internal pressure is, with the stress concentration is highest here. So these corners are broken off. Then I said that, okay, why not do X-ray diffraction? And we did X-ray diffraction, right? So in case of ordinary concrete, this pattern is known. Cement, ordinary. Then the X-ray diffraction pattern actually showed me a etrangite because 27, 9, 18, you know, the peaks that were coming in showed me there's an etrangite formation here, right? So just blown it up. Etrangites were very much there in this particular one. And internal sulfate, any of these cases, we didn't follow it up further. So all but two cases of river. Internal chloride induced rebar corrosion. All but two cases, not this rebar is not there, is actually internal chloride induced rebar corrosion. That's the major problem in our scenario. The quality of construction was a major cause. Cover depth. Well, ingredients and groundwater without ascertaining the level of chloride, low cover depth. Leakage of water, water accumulation, poor drainage, groundwater leakage to the basement. Therefore, in my opinion, major concern, I'm not sure because I have not seen some part of the south, maybe some other parts of India, but whatever I have come across, many from different parts of the India, largely, of course, in the northern India, I think this is a major concern. Internal chloride. So you can do any test, anything, but take care of this. And I suggest that, you know, you, the fraternity, can think. And it is not private building, builder's building, government building, everything included. Free and total correct test of samples from crust cubes shall be made mandatory, it's my opinion. You do cube test anyway, don't contaminate it. At least you see that the water that you are using for curing, or at least one or two cube, you can keep it separate. Put it in calcium hydroxide, a little bit of calcium hydroxide and distilled water. If, you know, if it's to be systematized or made kind of a mandatory sort of thing, or otherwise normal curing, but not with chloride and water, so that the chloride contamination is not there. Crush the cube, powder it, test for free as well as total chloride, because total chloride will give you long-term potential, free chloride is the current. Good lot of repair consultancy, which I have earned money, I would not have, and many others would not have, or would not be. So this is one concern. Other issue that I want to flag out here is other cause may be carbonation. And this is a process of diffusion of carbon dioxide in air feed pores. Chemical reaction with, of course, we know this, most of the people would be knowing this, and this is the pores where moisture, actually moisture would be, you know, if, as long as the moisture is there at the pore surface, the relative humidity is sufficiently high. There are intermediate reactions. I am not going here. I have left those. But I want to talk about this very much because I think this physics should be understood. And without understanding physics, some empirical things should not come anywhere. Osmotic pressure is created by the process of concentration gradient. Again, I'll not go into that. And diffusion is the process. So diffusion flux, that is quantity, the mass per unit, you know, this is mass, because area is here already put in. Mass that is going out, or mass per unit area, is proportional to diffusion coefficient D into concentration gradient. So if the concentration outside is C0, outside fixed 3%, 4% atmospheric carbon, CC is inside somewhere. Let's take an element DX. I know a little bit of maths is going in, but I think it is necessary. Without maths of this simple mathematics, if we are modeling for carbonation, I think we are doing disasters. Please, this should not be done. At least you understand the physics and then do. Empirical modeling is done, but empirical modeling is after understanding the physics. So carbon dioxide diffuses. Diffuses means molecular diffusion. They will collide with each other, Brownian motion, where they will not find their own species. They will enter there. That's so, you know that osmotic pressure thing in chemistry, somebody can look into it. So if I'm considering that up to the X distance, it has already got carbonated, and DX element, small element, is getting now carbonated. So it is react, you know, the amount of carbon dioxide which will come from outside will depend upon concentration here and concentration outside. Outside concentration is C0. CC is the inside concrete concentration, which is zero, I can take. And X is this distance, that's gradient, concentration gradient. And that's the driving force. If there are no concentration difference, carbon dioxide wouldn't have come. And this, through the carbonated concrete, is entering. And this is the diffusion coefficient of the concrete that is there. So that's Fick's law. And this must be neutralized at during the time dt period, small dt period, dq goes during dt period, small time interval. And that's A is the amount of alkaline material present in this. A into dv, the volume, that is dx into A, must be neutralizing. And we are assuming, of course, one thing, that it is getting fully neutralized, this small element. So if you now, I don't want to bring into this audience actually integration and all that, but this is what it is. So if I equate this, you know, this A will cancel out with this. This, if I put it, equals to zero because it is the carbon dioxide concentration here is been already consumed, whatever was there by alkaline material. So actually it will be dc by dx. Dx will go to the other side, right? And x will be there. This is equals to dt. Dt equals to, you know, dx dc. So I can write an equation of this kind, dt, you know, some constant k dx by, you know, x by x dx. Sorry, x dx will come. Sorry, dx will come in the x side. X will come here, so x dx will come. Equation will be of this form, dt equals to some constant, let's say capital K, x dx. Integrate both sides for time. Integrate the distance up to which it will get carbonated. This is x square by 2. So t will be some function of x square by 2. I cannot make it. So x will be t to the power half. I cannot make it 4.5 or 4.57. It's not possible. It's physics. You know, you measure g, acceleration due to gravity, by any method. You are not going to get it 9.8. Somebody is going to get 9.7. Somebody is going to get 9.9. Do I say that it is 9.9 for some other factor? No. So this is from physics, and you cannot change this. So t to the power half is sacrosanct. And this depends upon type of cement. This power doesn't depend upon type of cement, because the amount of alkaline material present will depend upon type of cement. PPC will have less, OPC will have higher. So this point I wanted to make very clear. This depends upon diffusion coefficient, depends upon concrete. A depends on cement type, right? And some, you know, if it is environment, carbon dioxide, C0 might depend upon carbon dioxide. So therefore, K might also include some. So industrial environment, C0 might be higher. So for God's sake, we shouldn't put in wrong things in code. So diffuses through the pores and with alkaline material, presence of moisture flux. That's what it is. So I think this is, I wanted to make a point. And in Ryland's book, Vesakari and Sarja's book, this is the model they have given. This model is not applicable in India. But I wanted to highlight, they have not put t to the power n. No, it is t to the power half only, unless you have a different, better physics model. There are models, but they also don't deviate from root t formula. K, of course, they have the European, you know, Sarja and Vesakari's book, Durability Design of Concrete, 1990s, C, air entrainment, environmental, A and B depends upon type of cement. So the K depends on type of cement. And if K depends on type of cement, T's exponent will not depend upon type of cement. It's already been taken care of. So this point I wanted to make, you know, but I'm not interested in this further. And they have actually verified also root T relationship. Right? Artificial climate and outdoor. You see, outdoor carbonation is less in Europe, not in India. Right? Outdoor carbonation is less because their concrete is most of the time saturated in subtropical climate. Either it is snowing or it's rain. And even when snow has melted, so majority of the part of the year, they will have actually a wet situation outside. Even when the sun is there, there is actually the relative humidity inside the concrete still might not, may not have dried off, exposed concrete. But inside, they maintain temperature. So depth varies with time. And it only takes place between particular set of humidities. Therefore, the set of humidity is not average humidity for a given climate, by the way, which apparently has been put in some quotes sometime. One of my senior colleague from construction was telling me, average humidity of a given location is not important issue. Actually, you'll find that there's a conducive period. So there is some period during which rain would cause wetting, and there's a critical moisture line, carbonation will progress up to this, and beyond that it will not, and again next year it will do, or next cycle it will do. So cycles of wetting and drying, that's very important. Because in India, say composite monsoon climate of Delhi, we have 2-3 months of rain. Therefore, conducive period will be certain period, degradation period will be this much. After that, it might dry off zone for conducive reaction. And next year, next cycle will start. So every year there is a quantum of carbonation or any other degradation for that matter. It is exposed concrete, not seepage or something of that kind. So wetting drying plays a major role. Therefore, climatic variation is very, very important. And if you see our Indian climate precipitation map, for example, rainfall pattern, it varies. These are all dry areas, right? Gujarat, Rajasthan, they are dry areas. Maximum rainfall somewhere there, right? So these are maximum rainfall areas, you know, somewhere here. And rainfall zone is available. I mean, my hydrology friends have done it. I'm not going into that in details, but this, one can keep that in mind, that this is dry, this is relatively dry. There are moderate areas. And if you put it in the climatic zone again, together you look at it, this is hot, dry desert climate. This is cold climate, this is cold climate. These are what we call warm humid climate, high rainfall. And this is composite monsoon climate where Delhi belongs to. There are some temperate or colder climate. And I have a coastal line where the chloride can come from outside as aerosol. I was trying to get that predictor service life, but unfortunately, the results did not show very, very encouraging thing, because there are internal chloride even there. I don't know what water they have used, what they have used, what sand they have used. It was another matter. My friend who was doing the work is no more. So you see, relative humidity, I'm not talking of temperature, precipitation, etc., etc. More than 6 months, hot and dry climate, relative humidity will be below 55 in this zone. You are unlikely to have much carbonation there, unless water leakage from the building itself. Warm humid, humid more than 6 months, you are likely to have 55%. Average humidity is 55%. But then in the day, of course, whole day is not going to be over 55. But then you have to actually find out within concrete what depth, what is the relative humidity. And moderate climate is somewhere there. We are not bothered about that. And cold and cloudy up below, you know, sometime above 55 relative humidity. So there, it could be there in terms of carbonation possibility. But there, frost action, I've not come across that, unfortunately or fortunately. So I thought that one can possibly classify the exposure zone for service life prediction. First, separate out marine zone, submerged. The problem is much less there. Chloride diffusion in saturated concrete, seawater attack, and you have take boundary condition for chloride diffusion accordingly. Mathematical modeling is necessary. Plus zone, Here again, chloride diffusion solution ingress unsaturated concrete. Chloride attack in unsaturated concrete. And therefore, chloride ingress will be in fact more here. There's a periodic boundary condition varying with time, velocity flux, etc., etc. 5 to 10 kilometers from the seashore, chloride accumulation to the surface followed by ingress with rainwater. Wind-driven rain-induced velocity flux. And if you look at non-marine zone, continental India, hot dry desert, little bit of rain, moisture ingress induced carbonation and corrosion can happen. And warm, humid, lot of moisture ingress. Because rainy season can be 5-6 months, unless climate is changing. At the moment, it's not happening that way. Exactly change for our durability of concrete. And the places where moisture ingress induced carbonation, composite monsoon, this can occur. But keep the internal chloride out. And then this is very high precipitation like Kodai Canal, because we have the data available. So again, rain penetration, rain induced carbonation can occur. So possible corrosion zones based on this, zone 1, zone 2, marine zone 1, marine zone 2, and marine zone 3 is the black. Non-marine dry zone is this. Non-marine wet zone is this color. And non-marine moderate, you know, monsoon related, NMM. And very high precipitations are, some of those are located here. And they are like Cherrapunji, Mosinram, some areas one can locate. And then modeling should follow based on this. In fact, the steel, they had similar kind of diagram, corrosion map of India. And there are various ways they have actually found out. I'll not go into this. So moisture ingress is an important thing. Again, I'm not discussing this equation, but this is what one has to do. Flow through porous media, Richard's equation, their solution for appropriate boundary condition, but this mathematics I'm not going to go, you know, and this is Lacy's, one of Lacy's equation, wind velocity, wind driven rain. We did some work on this. One of my students, whose faculty at IIT Mandi, did the work on those. And wind driven rain, and mathematical solutions can be there. And you can actually predict the wetting and drying. Relative humidity inside. So you can have drying, model them, and wetting, you can model them. And the problem comes here. The material property is called hydraulic diffusivity, and it is different in wetting and drying. Unfortunately, we don't have very good way of measuring this non-destructively. Non-destructive measurement is there. NMR is found to be the technique which may help, but NMR on small samples. Extremely costly. One instrument is available in Scandinavian countries. We tried to do with electrical system, not really succeeded as yet. Perhaps somebody, some of the followers will do. So we looked at from moisture distribution in concrete, wetting and drying scenarios. I'm not again going too much distance from exposed phase after a certain period of time, how much is the moisture distribution in concrete after wetting. And then we can actually, this is our work, of course, related to pore size distribution. I don't think I'm going to go into it. And moisture content you can determine knowing the pore size distribution using Kelvin's equation. So the pores up to which moisture will be filled, or relative humidity you can determine. So relative humidity you can determine, or pores up to your moisture content corresponded to this, what is the relative humidity you can find out. And then we did this. Of course, we used power models for capillary porosity. This is from our own model, the size of the pore and all that. And then we can find out moisture contents corresponding to lower level of corrosion, that is 60% or 70% relative humidity, 60% and 80%, something like that. Relative humidity, what is the sizes of the pores, reduced moisture content level in the concrete. 90% and 60%, yeah, that's what we have used. So what is the moisture content at during which it will be conducive for corrosion? And the rain pattern of Indian condition, actually also we have done. Conducive duration for, you know, total wet spell during which actually corrosion can occur for each of this climatic zone in India. This six station belongs to Jodhpur, hot, dry, warm, humid, Bengaluru, temperate, high, New Delhi, composite. So all this, you know, we did. But it did, needs to be done, a lot more work needs to be done on this. Diurnal rainfall variation and all that, we worked onto it. And typical moisture profiles, we could get it for different cities, for different concretes, but it is yet a lot more. And drying and wetting scenario, we simulated, but I think I'm not going to talk about this too much. But this, I think I should tell. So using this, you can find out the conducive time in days for corrosion. If the relative humidity is 60% and 20%. I mean, if it's varying, then it becomes complex mathematically, but one can solve. For Jodhpur, at the cover depth of 25, right? Water cement ratio points, 344 days, conducive days in for corrosion, that is 20 and 60% relative humidity. There 60% relative humidity is more, right? Kodai Canal 288, because relative humidity is higher, so corrosion doesn't occur. And for Madras, that is Chennai, because, you know, this IMD fellows call it still Madras. Therefore, we wrote it like this, but it's actually Chennai. So whatever it is. So that's kind of thing. And if it is 40 degrees centigrade outside and 60% relative humidity constant condition, then how many days it would require? Corrosion will occur in a year. That we can find out. At 100 mm depth, how many days? 25 mm depth, how many days? Etc. etc. So all 65 days it will not be. So I just plotted this cover depth versus what, you know, water cement ratio, moderate and low, right? Three water cement ratios, cover depth is so much, number of conducive days, this plot. And if you know the corrosion current density, then you can find out. So similar results can be worked out, but this is a sample. And corrosion map of India, again, they actually came out with an equation of this kind, K to T to the power N, corrosion rate kinetics, right? Somebody can look into this kind of scenario. So let me now talk about a little bit of chloride ingress. I hope I have some time. It's up to 5:30 or 6?
It's up to 6 o'clock. You can go up to 5:30 around. Then we can have some question assessment all.
I'll go up to 5:40.
No problem. Okay, sure.
So chloride ingress, we know that it's electrical potential fixed flow again. I'm not again going to explain this. This is the kind of model, but only point that I want to make here is, it's a specific boundary condition. It's a differential equation. And you got to solve it for specific boundary and boundary condition and initial condition. So for this specific boundary condition and initial condition, that is for an infinitely thick specimen, wall, let us say, before time equals to zero, that is initial condition, everywhere the chloride concentration was C0, which could be zero as well. And at T greater than, suddenly the surface has been subjected to a concentration CS, fixed, and it remains there. At the other phase where at infinity, other side, chloride concentration doesn't change. So it is something like this, a thick wall, infinity on this side, nothing changes here. Here suddenly you have given CS. Here suddenly, you know, it has been raised to CS and kept constant for infinite time in future. So this condition can only come into submerged concrete in marine environment, cannot come elsewhere, right? Now, if the groundwater condition is such that you have chloride, but then it is wetting and drying, this condition is not applicable. So even underground structure in Delhi, one should not have used this, but it has been used. I find it very surprising. I saw the design calculation, calculated the cover depth should be 30 mm. I think the understanding of the physics is poor there, or just the consultant wanted to give it straight away. Well, I suppose experience would have given us 30 mm or possibly slightly more, 35 and happier situation, or maybe 25, you know, 30 mm by perhaps experience also would have given us. So because 5 mm cover can save a lot of concrete if it is a large one. So it's a process of diffusion in saturated concrete, suddenly submerged. And fixed diffusion equation is valid. And its solution is available with us. This goes into my class, so I'm not solving it here using Boltzmann transformation and all that. And if you do that, you get an error function solution. Error function solution. This is it comes from heat diffusion equation, solution of heat diffusion equation, which has been available earlier. So for this boundary condition, this is the solution. Please do not use it indiscriminately anywhere you like. Only this boundary condition satisfies, this should be used. And there are softwares available which uses them just like that. Everywhere you can use this, I'm very proud. I have used, you know, X395 or something like that. So this is, please do not use this unless this is the boundary condition is satisfied, right? So there are equations based on that. Further modifications, they are simple. This is the final model, comes as life, service life, initiation time. But most of the cases, chloride would be unsaturated, right? In seashore, splash zone, and the equation is far more complex. I'm not going to go into that equation again. There is chloride storage, binding, chloride binding. So all this is to be taken into account. An error function solution does not represent real situation in any manner. It is suitable for de-icing salts, where they put it for a long period of time and the concrete remains saturated. So sodium chloride there gets dissolved into the water because ice is also, you know, basically depression of freezing point. So you put ice, freezing point will lower, at the current temperature, ice will start melting. And perhaps it works there. Parking lot in US or in Europe. But does it suitable for Indian situation? You please think about it. Then the test. The two tests are there. Whereas one test is non-steady state immersion test. Another is RCPT or immersion. RCPT is the other one under electric migration. And electric field doesn't exist in chloride driving anywhere. So this test is actually should not be used. It only tells you how much charge, how much resistance the concrete has towards charge transfer, that is resistivity of concrete. Well, if you are interested in resistivity of concrete, it is fine, but this should not be used for routine durability test. But here some or other, it has become very popular. We tried to do recently, one of my students again did. We tried to collect data from various people and fitted curve to the DA values they obtained through immersion test. It fits into, this is time, right? And exponentially related to the amount of porosity of the concrete or something of that kind. And time, very simple equation. But migration test, it also becomes function of temperature, so many things actually. So this is capillary porosity, so we're related to water cement ratio in a way. And here it is related to water cement ratio directly. So fitted the data available in literature. Two empirical equations we have plotted. And one, the difference between them is significant. One gives me 9.60, another gives me 12.06. This is, of course, we calculated because these data were available. Supplementary cementitious material was not there. Temperatures were available. They were, you know, 10 to the power minus 12 is there. They vary significantly. Although somewhere trend sometimes matches, but many a times they vary significantly. Therefore, there is something wrong with both the methods or at least one method for determination of diffusion coefficient. So you do not determine the diffusion coefficient. That's okay, but RCPT should not be used as a routine test in India. I don't understand why it should be in Delhi or even in, you know, Lucknow or Nagpur or something of that kind. but people insist. Now, we did some researches, again, one of my students. We tried to see how different steel type affect the corrosion initiation period. And those days, there are not many steel available, Thermex, Temperate, et cetera, et cetera. CTD bars, we tried, and it does affect. So initiation period with three types of cement, PSC took longer period of time compared to OPC, obviously, for different types of steel. So it varies with steel type and cement type, different water cement ratio also, where 0.45 initiation time was much higher. So my point is that it varies with the steel and the cement type, that we understand. And this was a, you know, starting clean steel, after some time we found corrosion has occurred in the throughout. So in marine zone, in India's class zone, important structure, power plants, onshore up to 10 kilometer, class one structures, class one by importance, right, which can cause catastrophe. We might use even bridges in coastal area in extremely severe, warm humid with a high rainfall. We might even think of using different types of steel as well, but it cannot be mandatory. For example, this is galvanized steel, right? Galvanized, hot dip galvanized iron. And they claim, or I have not tested, but the people who have tested, they say, or galvanizing society of Australia and US, particularly Australia, they say that I can understand that physics, I mean, physical chemistry and physics, one can understand that actually it will show you uncoated bar, and coated bar, it will increase, it will improve. So, but it's costly also. So therefore one has to look into life cycle cost and look into it. Epoxy bars, they too are good to a certain extent, but their comparisons are also available in literature. This is early 1900, this is 1973. All these are comparable cost, fusion bonding, hot dipping to straight bar, yes, possible to deformed bar, possible, but straight bar definitely. And these are thickness, coating adhesion, good, excellent. So there are some differences, but obviously perhaps this is written from the galvanized iron point of view, the person, the research paper that was there. But there is a problem related to, you know, you have to do damage repair. Here, sometime you have to do. Toughness, moderate, excellent. Moderate, excellent. Special handling, no. Barrier protection, yes, both do. Cathodic protection, no, but this does. Because the patina that is on the top, it acts like, you know, so there's actually calcium carbonate, zinc carbonate is formed at the top. And there can be some kind of, you know, the possibility of cathodically, electrochemically protecting it. So chloride resistance, this is supposed to have excellent if the coating goes on. And stainless steel. Japanese have great experience on this and it's come to India as well. So effective thickness decrease ratio, local corrosion coefficient, they came out with this equation. It's from Japan. Corrosion rate, T is the time, N is the corrosion index, and it is 1.25 for stainless steel, this K, compared to 1 for ordinary steel. So this stainless steel is other solution. This is their experience. Normal steel, carbon steel, stainless steel, localized corrosion, not, you know, general corrosion, too much area, and stainless steel, some high chromium content would give you much less depth here. So pitting corrosion occurs, but less, and they have given you a formula with respect to chromium percentage, molybdenum percentage, and, you know, it's, I think it's nitrogen percentage that they have given.
So, nitrogen percent, nitrogen.
Yeah, so N is nitrogen, but I thought in steel normally niobium also goes in, but this nitrogen.
Ni, that is
Ni. Ni, yeah, no, I know the symbol. That's not the point. But I was only thinking that I have not made a mistake.
No, it's correct.
Could be nitrogen. Yeah, nitrogen actually. Nitrogen is inert. So, right? So yeah. They have gray additive also. So you see, you can have, right? That's what it is. So other mechanical properties, 2% proof stress, et cetera, et cetera. So different types of steel, you can use them if required. It cannot be, I mean, I was told somewhere that one of the organizations has made it mandatory within certain 10 kilometers to use stainless steel. I'm not very sure about that, that kind of thing. Should really go on. Somebody might use galvanized steel. Somebody might use epoxy coated. But then they should calculate it, calculate the service life, and possibly do kind of, you know, gather experience and research. The cathodic protection is being very popular in India. Nowadays, that is not impressed current. I mean, this circuit is for both impressed current and as well as it can go for the sacrificial anode also. So this is becoming very popular in India. We did some experiment in 97 and all that in IIT Delhi. One of my master student did it. But then at that time I studied it actually. We did study. And then we can design the system. But unfortunately, wherever I've seen the application has been there, no design. They say we are putting our capsules, we have done it. Some measurements, actually it takes thorough measurement. This is not known in case of concrete. The corrosion current density. This is what the value used in pipes, buried pipes. We use the same. We have a paper in ICJ in 1997 or 98 sometime. One of my first PhD student and one of the M.Tech students, Professor Shamshad Ahmad, and he was the co-author of this with one of my M.Tech student. So that time we used this and we could calculate out. So design is not available. Unfortunately, nobody gives a design. You tell them, okay, how much current? I mean, you must measure the Husserl potential or corrosion current density and then design the spacing of all this. How many you need? And this is Faraday's law and nothing else. So this, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya. Thank you for an excellent presentation. Now I would invite our panelist, Dr. VBL Kantarao, for his comments.
Sir, having listened to such an excellent presentation by Professor Bhattacharya with all his experience, we cannot put any questions to Professor Bhattacharya, but being a panelist, I just want to know the internal chloride you have mentioned, Professor Bhattacharya, means the contamination of water and aggregates, I suppose is being referred here. How this contamination being happened in North India, Delhi areas or like that, or dry areas and all?
I am not really sure.
Huh?
I am not sure. I mean, one of the guests made.
Okay.
An official guess, I'll say.
I know. Okay.
From my experience of structures in IIT Delhi.
Right.
Largely they use groundwater. Also the house cast. RBI buildings, which they have demolished, given to Sapurji Palonji now.
Mm-hmm.
That groundwater there, you see, this is an arid, relatively, you know, composite monsoon climate.
Right.
Rainfall is only for two months or 3 months of the year. So surface chloride gets washed away, all right, but deeper you go into the groundwater, there's a lot of chloride.
But
Badarpur sand, which they are supposed to wash.
Right.
We paid for it also.
Yes. What was the other side?
So that is again pit sand.
Right. Yeah,
so
pit sand. Yeah.
Chloride has nowhere to go.
Correct. Yeah.
This will not happen with river sand.
Exactly.
Now, some cases I mentioned 7-8 years recently once. They're not in Delhi. One of them is, they're not in Delhi. I mean, Delhi Peri, NCR is there. One of them not in Delhi. I couldn't trace what is the source because they also, 7 and you know, already your building is the 7-8 years old. So they don't know from where what came, which place they got the sand or water perhaps is not there because I looked at the water quality.
Right.
That was available on net. So I was not, you know, I never thought it was water there because they know possibly the RMC plant gave from which place they didn't know.
Yeah.
And the other in south that I was showing you, that's goes to sea coast. So nobody knows. So that,
exactly.
Not very sure. But my point is that you don't have to source it later on. At least somebody is doing cubes testing, crush it down, make powder out of it. Don't do every day. Particularly for buildings. This will not happen for bridges.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Please go ahead.
Sir, in the ready-mix concrete plant, people are using the groundwater level of borewell water. What happened to that water?
Even that will be the same.
Because in BIS, it is already specified to use a certain type of water.
Who cares?
Yeah.
You know, that is the point. That's why I'm saying, finally, taste the pudding.
Okay.
Okay, that's what.
That's what, correct.
Taste the pudding. So why not make it mandatory? Those who of you are in the code committees, that you test the, you know, at least buildings.
Right.
I was busiest there, you know, the mechanized system, much because better quality control. Sir,
you did so much of study on the chloride ingress and chloride effect on the concrete. If suppose this ready mix concrete now almost 50 to 60% concrete, bulk concrete is being using ready mix concrete. So no, there will be.
No, no, sorry. Hardly 10% of the cement in the country goes through ready mix concrete.
Sir, that was 5 years back.
No, no, even today, because your cement production has also increased. Delhi city, yes, NCR, I might agree.
So that
Mumbai
means
I can agree.
I'm talking about the, because the NCR, if you take, there are 140 RMC plants. So most of the, I have, whatever I have noticed in last couple of years, that there, most of the concrete is being done through RMC. So that means RMC is also an influencing mechanism to chloride attack?
Can be. I'm not sure. Because I visited a plant long back in Nazafgarh.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, I have actually collected data from Unitech very early days.
Yeah.
Anuj Bhaneshwari, who was there other day, he was, you know, at that time working with...
When Sanjay Bahadur was there.
No, Sanjay Bahadur was the first one who started.
Okay, yes.
But Anuj was in Delhi. He was working, yeah. I think, for Unitech or one of them, SEC. Or whatever, no, SEC, I think.
Yes,
who collected data for quality control system.
ACC means the Faridabad. You are talking about the Faridabad.
Yeah, they had 4 or 5 plants in NCR region. Gurgaon, yeah. Faridabad, etc. I mean, all those days, 2003.
Okay.
So I collected data to show that if they adopt a good quality control, they'll save cement. We did keep some, etc. So I'm not going to that actually. But then I visited Nazafgarh because one of my clients wanted me to visit, and they said they wanted me to do mixed design. I said, I don't do mixed design. Principally, I believe mixed design should not be done at IIT Delhi lab. It should be done at the site.
But and sir, is there any month. Study has been done?
Just a minute, sir. Just a minute. 1 minute. Let me finish. Then he took me to Nazafgarh, where, from where they were doing, right? That fellow, the one who was handling the whole project, didn't know even what is water cement ratio. What are you talking of? I don't know if it has changed today.
It's
you
what?
Think he's going to look at the water? No. So test the concrete. Test the concrete. They are not all, you know, they are not qualified people who are handling the RMC plants.
Yeah, 100%.
And if it's L1 who's getting the concrete in a building project, it is not like Delhi Metro who actually gave the bulk of their concrete to L&T. And Mr. Yeah. Bachchan would have taken full care.
Yeah.
I don't know how is his health now. I heard that he was not so well. Some health issues.
But sir, is there any study? Is there any study carried out between concrete from the ready mix concrete plant and a designated batching plant? Or is there any studies carried out on the chloride effect and chloride diffusion of the concrete in a batch?
This you see, the production method will not change this. Production method will not change this. Batching plant is fine, and you do it there itself. From the batching plant to have an agitator truck, put it onto your mold. It won't have that kind of an effect. But see, the point is, that's what I'm saying. I don't know the our process of production is very peculiar.
Yeah, exactly.
The control.
Thank
is
you, sir.
You test tube, finally.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe single sir, you can take up questions
Yeah, there are a few questions. One is from Mr. M.P. Naidu. He's asking, nowadays from sustainability point of view, they are suggesting curing with carbon dioxide instead of water for curing.
Yeah.
How is it done?
Well, you see, the calcium carbonate is stronger than calcium silicate hydrate. But you have to have in a pica system. You just, you know, like you cannot trap carbon dioxide from atmosphere and cure it. That's not possible. It's from precursor element. And this is still, I'll say, is an experimental stage. It is such experimental stage.
The carbon curing is a very, very initial stage. In India, it has not yet started.
No, not India. I mean, the idea is to sequestration also.
Agreed.
But then, that's, you know, anyway, that all cement hydrates will eventually get converted into calcium carbonate.
Agreed.
You got it from calcium carbonate. Zameen se aaya, zameen pe jana hai wapas.
Jana hai.
It might take 1,000 years.
Achha,
we are only hastening it up, making it calcium carbonate, which is more stable and also stronger.
Actually, the carbon dioxide curing is coming. Means, as a sustainability point of view, it's being touched upon, but it is yet to take up actually. It's to be taken up.
Yes, I think.
There's a question from Mr. Sushil Kumar Dhawan. He's asking the cause of deep acidification and its effect on durability of RC elements. And then he's also asking, how can we determine the deterioration with respect to time?
No, that's right. I mean, basically, if you are monitoring it regularly, then of course you can you can find out how the deterioration is occurring with time, or you can do it. I mean, at the moment there are really not really non-destructive way, right? The chloride, some capsule you put in and it will capture. If it is inside, the very first day onwards corrosion will start. So corrosion rate measurements are available, and Dhawan Sahab has done one. He has used Repicor. So he knows that it's possible. So, well, how shall we work out the service life? No, that would need modeling. In the design stage, if we're doing, how shall we work out the service life of critical element? Well, environment is modeling in that case, if you're doing it at the design stage. At any stage, if you're trying to find out the condition and environmental condition, then also again, you can find out. There's no damage due to chloride ingress or carbonation. Damage is something different. Damage is because of wind or earthquake load. This is deterioration.
Yeah.
Marine area durable structure is possible. You have to take care of it in whole integral manner. Design it. It is possible. I think those are his questions.
That in the chat. And Dr. Bhattacharya, there are some people who are asking, they wanted to share the presentation. They're saying, can you share the presentation with them?
PPTs, no?
Yeah.
I'll do that. Don't worry. I'll pass it on to Dr. Rao.
Yeah.
And he's the boss. They're the boss. I mean, Supradeep. they're the boss. So I can pass to
you. No, sir, no.
I can pass on to you. No copyright for this. And many of these, except for some of those which I have just added, they're available in NPTEL or otherwise, here and there, whenever I speak.
Achha, Dr. Bhattacharya, I wanted to ask one thing. In a city like Delhi, for concrete construction, should we go in for corrosion resistant steel or our ordinary steel will do?
Oh, ordinary steel should do, actually. Why do you have to? I mean, where is the corrosion here?
Yeah, because a decent steel
was... But do not use Nazafgarh concrete. Make sure that you are not putting chloride or cancer in the day zero.
Yeah, because recently our CPWD, they have issued a circular which makes it mandatory to use, you know, corrosion resistant steel. So I just wanted to know
that
we should actually go for revision of that.
I do not think so. You can do without it, but provided you are taking additional precautions. I mean, you cannot cover up, you know, your bruises inside your body, which you have created by bad behavior, with a good cloth. So it's covering bad concrete. You can't cover
bad quality concrete.
Corrosion resistant steel, I'm not very sure about.
But sir, durability will be enhanced whether Delhi is a low humid.
But first, sound. If your concrete is bad.
That is there.
So that would be everything.
Porosity. Porosity.
I'm not selling that ISKCON.
I think porosity should be reduced.
And then we'll go for so many preventive measures.
Unless the first thing is, you know, you've already done all mess. Now you want to cover it up. That's In fact, Tata's, I wanted to do, you know, one of my, as I said, Professor Bulu Pradhan, he was doing his PhD, we wanted to, and Jitu Kujur, the two other students of mine who were doing PhD, we wanted to have Tata Tiscon, corrosion resistance bar.
Yeah.
PRS bar. They said, we don't supply to North India.
In fact, I tell you, in fact, for one of my studies, I tell you, I had requested Tata people and they have got it separate, especially from Tata to Kanpur, this thing, and from there I got it.
Yes.
They frankly said that they don't supply to North India.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, in fact, Jitu could get it because he is from Ranchi.
Okay, okay.
And he personally went to, Tata's.
Right. Okay, okay.
Because he's from Jharkhand.
I got it from them, but.
He could get it. For carbonation one,
but right,
for
right.
Chloride one of Professor Bulu Pradhan, we couldn't do that.
Okay.
There's a question from Shweta Goel. She's asking, what is the effect of corrosion inhibitor layer on the surface of concrete on diffusion rate? Will the square root law still be applicable?
Yeah, corrosion inhibitors, square root law will be still be applicable, but square root law will be applicable, but what will not be applicable, I mean, what will be different is K. The square root is related to diffusion of carbon dioxide to the site.
Yeah.
But the K, now if you put an inhibitor, it will actually stop the corrosion rate, not carbonation as such.
Okay.
Either it is an anodic or cathodic or mixed.
Yeah.
So it will stop the kinetics of the corrosion process by scuffling out one of the reactions, anodic reaction, cathodic reaction or both?
For both, yeah.
But then depassivation is carbon dioxide. It will delay because the kind of, you know, the corrosion initiation itself also will be delayed because of the this one. And I think their studies there at their own place, they have done some studies from using corrosion inhibitors. So I'm involved, as involved, so I know about it. So it would be actually, but time will increase, K will change, T to the power half will remain.
Okay. I think we have covered all the questions. We have covered all the questions. So I think we can end the session now with a vote of thanks. So I invite Mr. Wadhwa.
Yes, sir. Should I start?
Yeah.
Just a minute, sir. There's one more question from Mr. Kalgal, Dr. Kalgal, sir.
Just now it might have come.
Yeah, does speed of movement of carbonation front decrease at increasing depths? Speed of movement of carbonation front.
It can.
Yeah.
Because you see, the carbonated concrete will have lower diffusion coefficient.
Yes, yes.
It will actually decrease, but T to the power half formula still might be there.
Yeah, yeah. It's in chart session, sir. Chart mein diya tha unhone, all the question.
Okay, okay, okay.
Yeah. So D would change.
Yes, sir.
D would change.
Right,
but
right.
Having said that, you know, the overall carbonation model is far more complex than that I wanted to show.
Yeah. That's right.
But I was only countering the recent thought that have e to the power 0.45 or 5.1 or something of that kind.
Right.
From basic science understanding, no, you can't do that. Right? You have empirical data, you can fit log on both sides, so the exponent will come as a, you know, a slope.
Right.
But that's what you will have an error in measurements.
Yeah.
But carbonation model is far more complex than what I'm talking of. There's a paper by Papadakis.
Right.
You know, it's far more complex. And in fact, some of our work, which of my, you know, colleague, Dr. Bishnoi.
Yeah.
One of our students used quite a bit of modeling on that. Right.
So, Achha, one last question, Bhattacharya. Are we able to really determine the initiation period of a concrete, given the, we don't know the type of cement used or the chemical composition of cement used, H3 and all. These uncertainties, have we come to the stage to determine the initiation period of a concrete structure?
No, see, there would be like you can, you know, one has to, basically the problem remains with the material properties, measure.
Exactly.
How do you measure them?
Yes. That for the old structure.
Even for the new structure, how do I measure them?
Yeah.
There are a lot of uncertainties in this measurements, is at the moment, methods of measurement, in fact.
Right.
I was trying to show related to chloride.
Correct. Yeah.
Same goes with carbonation. So carbon dioxide diffusion coefficient.
Exactly.
And if the mass balance equation has got more terms, which I didn't show here,
right.
How do we find out all those material properties?
Right.
But first of all, the methodology, then there will be still uncertainty in the material where a very parameter variation.
Yeah, that's
right. You can take care of statistically.
But right. Sir, ACI committee has come out one study about the initiation process of the corrosion to be taking place. ACI has brought out a study report.
No, that's okay. That must be. But I'm saying that must be. There is no, you know, that they might have, because things are not stopping.
Yeah.
That's what happened.
But an engineer will have to construct. So if, you know, the architect or constructor of Qutub Minar had to wait for Newton, they would have waited for another 500 years. Yeah. The Dhamesh in Sarnath, or the temple in Meenakshi, Amman's temple in Madurai, they would have waited for 1,000 or more. So the science will gradually take over.
Right.
Our understanding improves. Empiricity is there, experience is there. Code set, that's why civil engineering uses code, electronics engineering uses much less code. Because they use material which are produced in the factory.
Factory, yeah.
Thanks to Rawal Saab, they are producing something in the factory and they are allowing us to control the concrete system better. I mean, the chemist and the, you know, polymer scientists and so on, chemical engineers and so on. So, yes, because IS 456, 1964 was the first
one.
Even that had some durability issues.
Yeah.
Right? Or BS CP 110 and then 8114, they were pretty old. They had something. Understanding of the current day is put in the code by those people. So current understanding, SEI must have put in through a large committee, and their research that goes on. I mean, we annoy us. Just cannot think of it, even compared to a country like small country like Switzerland or Germany.
Yeah.
The amount of research that they have, we don't have that much. So therefore, we adopt from abroad all that. But my only point is, adopt with understanding, not wrong things.
Thank you, Prasadji. Vadhva sir.
Yes, sir. Okay. Namaskar, everyone. Good evening to respected speaker, the panelists, the moderator, all the participants, and associates of Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center. After an exciting presentation by the eminent speaker, useful comments and observation by the expert panelists, and the interventions by the panelists through questions on the topic, it's my proud privilege to express gratitude and propose a vote of thanks to everyone. On behalf of Indian Concrete Institute, New Delhi Center, in association with Civil Engineering and Construction Review, CER&CR, powered by Revered Media, I would like to thank the Honorable Speaker, Dr. Biswajit Bhattacharya ji, Emeritus Professor, Civil Engineering Department, IIT Delhi, for his enlightening presentation on the topic, which is different from a normal cement and concrete technology. Issues related to the deterioration of and service life of concrete elements in Indian context. He very well explained about the various common causes of deterioration, their diagnostic methods, and including improvement modes in service life of concrete structures, supported by various case studies. Thank you so much, sir, on behalf of ICANDC team and the entire civil engineering fraternity, for an excellent and informative lecture. We are also thankful to Dr. VVL Kantarao ji, Senior Principal Scientist, CRRI, and Honorary Secretary, ICANDC, for consenting to be our eminent panelist and deliberating and offering his valuable feedback and comments. Thank you, sir. Thanks to Engineer Rajiv Singhal ji, Chief Engineer Tripodi, and Chairman ICANDC, and today's moderator for very well managing and carrying out this 11th webinar in the series, in association with our partners, in a highly professional way. Thank you, sir. Our sincere thanks to Engineer Vinay Gupta ji, National President ICAI and Director and CEO TCPL, who could not make his presence today due to some other urgent assignment. An expert planner, civil engineer, and advisor related to all types of structures. His efforts in guiding, arranging such interesting webinars for the benefit of civil engineers, contractors, consultants, students all over the country through Indian Concrete Institute is highly commendable. Thank you, sir. Thanks to Engineer Superdeep Dasji, Vice President North, ICAI, for presenting the objectives, roles, the present activities of ICAI and future plans relating to the concrete and construction. He also highlighted about the ICAI publications. Thank you, sir. Sincere thanks to Engineer Rajiv Singhal ji, Chairman, Dr. VVL Kanta Rao ji, Honorary Secretary, Engineer Mayank Rawal ji, Co-Chairman, and all the committee members of ICAI-NDC for taking initiative at their personal level in arranging unique and knowledgeable lectures related to the present day need by persuading and inviting specialists in their respective fields to impart knowledge to all concrete lovers. I want to express my thanks to our associates, Mr. Pradeep Bhattacharji and his team, entire team of civil engineering and construction review, and Rubber Media for their logistics support and making necessary arrangement in organizing the webinar in a professional way. I'm extremely thankful to all the concrete loving participants for attending in large numbers and making this webinar successful. They're requested to involve their friends, colleagues also to have benefits of the useful lectures. Thank you once again. Thank you so much. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.